All right. Hey,
I guess I'll stand next to. Okay. Hi, everybody. Welcome to Amanda Cheromiah's dissertation defense. I'm so honored to be here in the physical presence of her very close family, friends, supporters, allies, partners, as well as her committee, Dr. Sheila Nicholas and Dr. Gary Rhodes. My name is Jenny Lee, and I've served, honored to serve as Mandy's dissertation chair. We go way back. I've known her since she was an undergraduate student with Project SOAR, and now hopefully soon to be Dr. Cheromiah. So thank you all for coming. This is an unusual dissertation defense in that this is not just a typical dissertation study as we may, if you have attended a defense before. This is actually a powerful set of stories about healing, about self-determination, about community determination, the power of running, but most importantly, this is the power of storytelling as we are on indigenous land of the Pascua-Iqui and Tohono nations most recently. And really, we want to honor all of you that are here physically as well as via Zoom. So without further ado, I will turn it over. Mandy will take us to our next speaker.
Awesome. Just want to make sure everyone's ready. Perfect. Okay. Great. Well, before we start, I'd like to invite Lois Liston to unmute yourself. Lois has been a great mentor and elder to us and to our community. I've known Lois for about 10 years when I started early academic outreach. She does a lot of community engagement and blesses a lot of us with her songs. And so it'd be appropriate. She's from the Thonathom Nation, and it's appropriate for her to open up this space for us.
Okay. Skirtash, Anyap Jurgik, Lois Liston, Anyap Amjit Archukshan, Anyam Ki Archukshan. Good day. My name is Lois Liston. I come from the community of Little Tucson, and I live in that community. The song that I'm going to share says, "There is a brilliant circle glistening. It is the morning star rising. Brilliant circle glistening around us." And that describes Amanda to me right now, because of all that she has gone through and all that she has persevered through and at this moment. Kahua sikona no aika. Kahua sikona no aika. Dokyara ma a si uwing. Kanhu chu shachi. Kahua sikona no aika. Kahua sikona no aika. Kahua sikona no aika. Dokyara ma a si uwing. Kanhu chu shachi. Kahua sikona no aika. Kahua sikona no aika. Dokyara ma a si uwing. Kanhu chu shachi. Kahua sikona no aika. Kahua sikona no aika. Dokyara ma a si uwing. Kanhu chu shachi. Kahua sikona no aika. Kahua sikona no aika. Dokyara ma a si uwing. Kanhu chu shachi. Kahua sikona no aika. Kahua sikona no aika. Dokyara ma a si uwing. Kanhu chu shachi. Kahua sikona no aika. Apua. Joshua, this is a mic, Amanda. Apua. Blessings to you.
Lois.
Thank you.
I really appreciate you. I appreciate your community. Your people are a beautiful people, Lois, and I really appreciate you coming today. Next, we're going to have our sister, Kia. Kia Etsiti. She's from Zuni Pueblo. She's our sister. We laugh because we're a study abroad success story. And so we traveled to New Zealand together in Australia, and she is a wonderful person. And we invited her to come into this space and open up with a prayer in Zuni. Kia?
All right. Thank you, Mandy. Aloha, me here. So I'm going to offer the prayer in Zuni, and you can pray in your own way too for Mandy's continuous strength of her ancestors that she brings before us, and that she, everything that goes well today and on this Zoom. So,
It's got to tap my death like we him on that you don't not so hollow in the night. And tell you up. On our don Halloween in a yantana, so making a locking conde, yam only a cabina, lamp flashy a cabina, cashamabina, doshan and udiana, deokanana, sauket at McDume, is got caught down for any Halloween in a bin, like a hot dalcoa, cal hot non don yanic chopper, a cat don, Illinois caggy yam. Yet the Kadacha on earth and quiet nickly, on earth and dead chickly, E be a tumor, but egan of love answer my yam letting a horn ee and a buddy, yam letting a horn ee and a yannick and oa. Look at yet the nerve, her mother that chewed that not to hollow in their thought, I'll turn up, but yam on the queen that care, on our hollow din a yam than a tumor, can a echo ee me chummy, low on our listic lab, bonny door, show on our chow, on our flash in our honour ee and the kina, on our chow, on our on earth and dash in the kina, on the earth and gokshi qua hot, I can't order who you know, yannick in a. Hot not done answer my decon bashin yanik chip to Hamadachu. Thank you for having me be here today and offering the prayer. Pray for Mandy through this, and it's gonna be good. Alakwa, thank you, Mandy, for inviting me and for being here today, everybody. I'll turn it back over to you.
Thanks, Kia. Kia's from Zuni, which is right outside of Gallup, New Mexico. So the language that she spoke is an isolate language, is only located right there in Zuni Pueblo. So thank you so much, Kia. Great, well, welcome everyone. The way that I see this is like a feast day back in our community. When we have feast days, a big celebration of food and dancing. And we just tell friends and family, hey, just come. And so a lot of you have just come, which is awesome. And so for if you don't know, here there's about 12 of us, 13 of us here in the room in College of Education. And so it's kind of a hybrid model here. But welcome to this presentation. It's a gathering of this piece of work. I printed it out just as for my rough draft so I can make notes and stuff. So it looks like this thick right now. It's called The Indigenous Revolt in Education, Indigenous Feet, A Scholar's Case. And I'd like to acknowledge my committee, Dr. Jenny Lee, Dr. Sheila Nicholas, who's Hopi, and Dr. Gary Rhodes. who's all a part of our family and great, great mentors to me. As I start, I'd like to introduce myself in our traditional language called Keres. Gwatsi, Kautuista, Eshaskatana Hondusta, Wishisa, Baho Pashtra, Wishata, Shameshia, Java Matsani. My Indian name was Kaltui, and the left picture right there is my great-great Yaya, Kaltui. So that's who I'm named after. And it is a great privilege to be here, to stand here. It's a miracle that our Indigenous people are here, and I recognize that it is a great privilege to be at this level, which I like to call 22nd grade, which is this PhD in higher education. And so my roadrunner, my clans are Turkey and Roadrunner. And as you can see there on the right, those are my two clans. So those of you that filled out and gave me your address, I'll be sending you stickers that my mentee Seema made. He's from Hopi. So he created those stickers. Here's a brief roadmap of our presentation today. And I want to make sure everything's good with tech.
You are. Yeah, I can't see anything.
Okay, give me a second here. In this Zoom world, we got to figure out some things. All right, now we're back online. All right, so our roadmap here. So I'm going to give a presentation. And at the very end, there'll be time for questions from the family members that I have here, from friends here, but also from all of you that are joining online. So if you have any questions, please put it in the chat box. My friend Charlinda and Felice are going to help me navigate that and answer those questions, because there's a lot of us here. Around 2:50-ish, I'm going to leave here with my committee. They're going to give me feedback for about a good 50, 55 minutes. We're going to come back to the room while that's happening. Felice and Charlinda are going to facilitate just the conversation. I would love to hear what you have to say. So please, in that time, if you have time, please stay here, give feedback, because I'll watch the recording afterwards. We'll come back around 3:50-ish, 3:55-ish. President Robbins is going to be here to share just a couple of words and greet us. And then Dr. Nicholas will close with the prayer. So in this space, I would love for you to use the chat function throughout the presentation, especially when you will have questions or have feedback. Just put it in there in the chat. I'd love, love, love to read it. And so please, and you can share the save the chat at the end, that'd be great too. So the chat function will help me to engage with you later. But for those that are online, you can see the discussion going on. So please use the chat. I am partially blind. When you look at me, you might not recognize that, but I'm partially blind in both eyes, and so I will be using my magnifier throughout the presentation. If you get motion sickness, just close your eyes and just listen to me. So it gives you kind of a sense of, it takes me about twice as long to do things, and it's quite challenging. And for those that are out there that may also be blind to or partially blind, I want you to know that it's possible to do many things. It's okay to cry. I want to share in this space because sometimes in the academy, it can be a hostile place where emotions aren't welcomed. But in this space, it's okay to cry. Crying has been an integral part of this process. And I want all of you to feel comfortable and welcome to do that. I want to acknowledge the graphics were created by the Chippewa Cree artist, Kayleen J. Big Knife. She is amazing. So these graphics were made by her. And I want to acknowledge my committee, as well as Dr. Amanda Ticini, for it is through their leadership and their work that they propelled me into this level of creativity and academic freedom that I did not know was possible. So I just want to acknowledge you. And I also want to dedicate this presentation to the Havasupai people. They are a beautiful people. And this is an example of how research with Indigenous communities, how we uphold this high level of standard of research and inquiry. So we honor them and we acknowledge them. So in this space, I'm going to share a story with you that's about generational blessings. A story about endurance, a story about Indigenous runners, and in this time, we're going to run a marathon together. No matter your fitness level or ability, we're going to start and finish the race together. No one gets left behind. And I want to acknowledge here this photo that was taken in 1884, but it's the students of the Carlisle Industrial Indian Boarding School. For it is through these students that I am here today, that many of us are here today. And in this presentation, I'll have an opportunity to honor an integral member of the Carlisle Indian community, Tiwanima. And he's a big part of my journey, as well as his granddaughter, Dr. Nicholas. But I want to acknowledge them in this space. And one of the reasons why I cut my hair, I had COVID earlier this year. I cut off 17 and a half inches. And one of the reasons why I did that was to honor these young people here. Because when you see their hair, it's about as short as my hair is right now. Okay, so all of you are getting a running bib. So a running bib is really cool because in marathons, I've ran one marathon in my life. My mom, who's sitting in here with me right now, she's run seven, is that right, Mom? Seven marathons. And so it's pretty special when you get a running bib because you can put it up in your room, you can frame it, all kinds of cool stuff with it. But all of you today get a running bib because you're running along with me in this journey. And this is where the story begins for this presentation and this story here. I want to share a film with you, the short film. I had created a film in 2018 as a method of healing. And I'll play this right here, give you a little bit more context after this. Why do I run? You know, this fall 2018 semester has been one of the most challenging semesters I've ever had because, in a sense, the trauma that I've experienced since I was a little girl has caught up to me, and it's impacted me in ways that I couldn't foresee happening this semester. And 6 weeks ago, I went to get professional help for the first time, and one of the recommendations is to exercise at least 30 minutes a day because it's a natural antidepressant. And so since that point, I've been working out about six times a week. And most of the exercise that I do is running. And running has been a way for me to relieve stress and anxiety. And it's provided an outlet for me to clear my mind, but then also to consider, you know, what I'm called to do. And so running is a way of life for me, especially in this season of time, because it rejuvenates me and it helps me to think clearly. And so I run for myself, for my mental well-being, for my health. And as my professor said too, she told me, she's like, run for those of us who can't run. So that season of time was a very, very dark time. There were many times where I didn't know what life was for me anymore. And by a miracle, I was saved and brought to a place of restoration. And to describe that process, I created a model called the Strands of Healing and Restoring Model. And so here you can see the spider web that has different elements that have helped me in my healing journey. And one of those elements is photography and videography. And this is how this whole story of creating Indigenous Youth Scholars Space was birthed.
One of my Dr. Nicholas stories inspired me to create this film. Mid-semester, Dr. Nicholas attended a gathering at the former grounds of Carlisle Indian School in Pennsylvania. She shared with others about her clan father, Tiwanima, and his journey as a Hopi runner. When Dr. Nicholas returned back to our class, she shared about her trip. She mentioned how she met a descendant of Tom Torlino, who is known for being one of the most recognized people in the before and after photographs captured in the boarding school era. Tiwanima's story impacted me as a runner, so much so that I chose to create a film about Indigenous runners for my final project. As I began to share pieces of my film on social media, I soon realized that many people were interested in seeing the project. And that's how this movie was birthed.
So it was through Tiwanima's story, through Dr. Nicholas, that I knew the conditions at Carlisle Indian School, where students were forcibly put in positions to do things, to learn in ways that they weren't accustomed to. And it was a time where Indian children had a really challenging time. And I knew that Tiwanima was at the school that birthed this whole generations of trauma. And because I knew that Tiwanima could make it in the boarding school, I knew that I also too could make it. And so his story really inspired me to know that I could make it. And so I set out on a journey. It was cool because in this room is where I heard the story with Dr. Nicholas here in one of the classes that she taught, the Indigenous Wellbeing course. And I set out on a journey and asked 10 runners, or 9 runners, I guess, mainly 2 questions. Why do you run? And how do you use running in the academy? That was at the core of what I was curious about. But from that, these 10 runners emerged. Jesse Navarro, who's Donna Autumn, Karen Francis Begay, who's Dine, who's also right here in the room with me today. Dr. Mom, that's who I call her, AKA Dr. Royaline J. Ross, who's from our Pueblo, Laguna Pueblo. Isaac, I'm not gonna pronounce your last name because I don't know how to say it right. who's Dakota and Dine. Alpha Joy Smith, who's Filipina and Dine. Lydia Jennings, today is her birthday. Happy birthday, Lydia. I wanted to give you a shout out. Pasco Yaki and Wichol Tribe. Dr. Sheila Nicholas, who's Hopi. Tiwanima, who's Hopi. Tiffany Sorrell, Dine. Alejandro Higuera, who's Pasco Yaki. And so those were the 10 runners. And so in May 2019, what we did was, as a collective community, came together and it created the film, interviewed all of them, and created a full-length film. And so along with my buddy Alejandro, we showed it at the Last Cinema here in Tucson, and that was the full-length film. And so here's all the runners together at the Loft, and this was in May 2020. That was in 2019. That in May 2020, during the pandemic, I had released the film publicly on YouTube. So the filming was a private showing, but then in 2020, I made it public. And so that is why now in this space that the runners are public, because it's a public piece of, it belongs to our community in a public way. And so this film, the film transferred and it transformed into a dissertation. Shout out to Dr. Gary Roach, who's in the back right now, because in a meeting, he, from the very beginning, he said, this is your dissertation, Mandy. This is your dissertation. It took me some time to get it. It took me some time to figure out how to transfer that into a dissertation, but it was Dr. Rhodes that planted that seed to this be a dissertation. Here is the roster. So I tried to keep it within this kind of athletic theme here. Here comes the magnifier. Close your eyes if you get motion sickness. 10 participants. There was seven tribal nations represented, 4 male participants, 6 female participants. And within the age division, 18 to 22-year-olds, there was 2, Alpha Joy and Isaac, 30 to 35, which is 4, 45 to 54, 2, and then 55 plus, there was 1. So that was the breakdown, and of course, Dr. Nicholas shared Tiwanima's narrative. The research questions, there was 4 of them. The first research question was, why do American Indian students, faculty, and staff run? So again, I had to transfer what I had created in my mind and in the film into research questions. So I was kind of working backwards. Another question is how do American Indian students, faculty, and staff in higher education conceptualize their experience as runners in the academy? Also, what challenges do they face within a non-Native serving institution? And then how do the folks, how do American Indian students, faculty and staff conceptualize collective and individual self-determination in higher education? And I put parentheses there because Tiwanima wasn't in higher education, but the rest of us, the rest of the runners were. There was 2 frameworks that I used. A very frequently cited author, Dr. Brian Brayboy, at Tribal Critical Race Theory. And essentially at the core, his framework is an offshoot, I guess, of critical race theory. But in this particular framework, colonization is endemic in society. That's the driving point. And there's 9 different tenets. And one of the main important tenets to me is that stories are theory, because story is the driving force of this I think it's a movement of this movement of understanding and presenting stories. And in this particular context, he defined sovereignty in four different ways, but I'm using three of those ways that he defined it: self-determination, self-identification, and self-education. Self-determination meaning that Indigenous people have their right and the ability to determine their own futures in education, within politics, however that may look like. Self-identification is that Indigenous people can identify themselves how they want to, not somebody else defining for them, like our ancestors unfortunately had to experience in the boarding school era. They were told, you look like this, you sound like this, and you dress like this, right? But now we're in this time where we can celebrate who we are, where I can sit before you in this classroom and wear my Indian clothes, where our Indian students weren't able to do that before. So there's an expression there. And then self-education is where Indigenous people fit within the context and recognize it fit within the context of their larger community. So those are the three that I use in terms of Rainboy's framework. The other one is Spiderweb by Dozier Enos in 2017. She's a Pueblo scholar. Basically, her framework talks about research is non-linear and messy, which when I saw this, I was so excited because in my mind, I feel like that's what it's like. It's just all these like spiderwebs going through. And that the strands interconnect in very special and beautiful ways. And at the end, when the spider creates her spider web, it creates something very beautiful. So the graphics are very intentional. If you see there's a spider web there, there's a spider web there on the flowers. So keep that in mind, the spider web, how these strands connect. The methodological standpoint here, this is very important to me in terms of Indigenous imagination, which is Graham Smith. So essentially, this Indigenous imagination is thinking about and dreaming beyond what we can even see or think, and especially in the context beyond of what colonization has done to Indigenous folks, because we can experience it in many different ways, but it's thinking beyond like what the oppressor has put on our people. And so the second one too is mind map and knowledge as cloud, which is Kahete. Knowing that within our mind that we have these cultural maps. So when I was planning all this stuff, I was like, okay, my map is all over the place. Like, how do I know this? How do I know how to organize this? Because it's all in my brain, right? And I had to put it on a lot of pieces of paper. And so, but it's this cultural map that we have as Indigenous people in knowing where to go and how to go and how to go about it. And so knowledge is clouds, is when you go outside that knowledge forms when it needs to, and then it dissipates. So that is my mind, and I welcome you to the mind of Amanda Cheromiah. So this is the framework here. I tried to put it on a piece of paper, but if you look at it, it's quite simple. Thinking about the concept of time, very fluid, but at the very top, it's like this research. This is my methodological standpoint. It's messy and it's everywhere. But in Rainboy's framework, he also talks about an Indigenous lens. And when you look through education through an Indigenous lens, you're going to see a lot of different things that are very different in terms of beliefs, in terms of culture, in terms of practices. And so here are all these different like culture, tribal philosophy, self-determination, all of that comes together. But at the very end of it, at the bottom, our culture is preserved. So that is powerful because this is how my mind thought about all of what happened here, that the runner shared their story with me and that I had this responsibility to take care of their stories and to frame it in a way that honors our narratives and preserves our culture. So that's my mind. So with that, I came up with this motto. I was thinking about all the grandmas that I know. My grandma Obi's here. My grandma Jean is on the top left, and our Baba Robert, who passed away last year. There's my friend Val, the top right with all the greenery, and then Marianne Tagban, who is also an awesome grandmother and a dear friend, who is Felice's mom. And when you think about your grandmas, when you go to their kitchen tables, man, you feel loved. You look forward to what they're cooking, you look forward to how it sounds. You look forward to the stories that are going to be shared there. They create this loving and welcoming space for you where you know that you can do anything you want. And you know that you are encouraged to lift up your people. They show you how to do that. And so I created this model called the Grandma's Kitchen Table Effect. And the way that it works, it's very simple. This is the mentality. This is what my grandma's taught me, that when you are in this space where you create a loving, warming, and welcoming environment, just like at grandma's table, when you learn those values, you feel safe and you feel worthy, loved, and important. And the stories naturally unfold, and this trustworthiness and respect are established. And in that, your culture is preserved through storytelling. So this is the very mentality and the values that I carried with as I went to speak with these different leaders, different runners. And so grandmas, we salute you, we love you. Thank you so much for helping to create this model. In terms of forming the themes, now this is like, remember, it was like a movie. It was about a 65 minute long movie. This is how I create the themes or cluster it together. This is really important to kind of understand this. Again, this was all in my mind, so I had to figure out how to do this. But just going from the top here, you start with the storyteller. So for example, Dr. Mom, we have Karen, and we have Dr. Nicholas. So we have the storytellers. And when they would share the stories, I would record them. I listen to their stories, and I would repeatedly listen to them. And I would also record videos and photos of them. But then also, when that happened, when I was gathering the data, and I would pray, I would really pray to figure out, how do I put these together? How do I weave their stories together? And again, bringing in that Indigenous imagination with my mind map, all that stuff in my head, it comes down into starting to form themes. And these themes were formed through pairing videos and photographs with interview audio and video editing software. And then what happens is that the storyline unfolds and this film emerges. So that is my process. I hope it makes sense. If it does not, please give me some comments to let me know, because I can make it better, because my deadline's not till the end of the month to turn in my stuff. So I want to show you how this works. So here we have tomorrow, and you see at the very bottom, that's the timeline. There's those images. The green at the bottom is the music. The blue is the audio. So it's like pairing together all these different things and weaving it together. Again, kind of weaving and making this spider web. So that's what it looks like. And that's, prayer was the ultimate force that helped me to do this. All right, so now looking at the themes here. Okay, so there are, I call them the different Indigenous footprints, because we think about this idea of moving and it's leaving a mark. There are 5 mile markers that, 5 emergent themes that came from this and hearing all of their stories. Here, I'll just run through them really quick. Mile marker A, ceremony and the running tradition. What emerged from that is prayer, ceremony and the running tradition, and the messengers. So those are some themes that emerged within that. In mile marker B, we have collective and individual self-determination. The footprints that emerge, multifaceted dimensions of self and the community, self-actualization, tradition and cultural protocols, and as well as holistic worldviews. And mile marker C, connection to the land and Mother Earth. This one is a huge tenet. And so if you are a huge finding, so when the dissertation comes out, I really recommend you look at this. Traditional and cultural protocols, and holistic worldviews. Mile marker D, which is health benefits from an Indigenous perspective, perspectives from men of color, as well as time and friends, physical and emotional benefits. And mile marker E, which is one of the most influential one in terms of the field that I'm within, higher education, but it's navigating the academy, running as sovereignty. So it's within self-determination, self-identification, and self-education. So this was a lot, but overall, the general notion was that running was not a sport, that running is deeply embedded within Indigenous cultures. I want to share a couple of clips with you that kind of give you an idea of what the runners said themselves.
I run partially to honor my family. Most of my family members are runners. I run for myself to clear my mind, clear my body, and then really connect with the landscape spiritually. As you know, I'm an environmental scientist, so sometimes I think, especially while in school, you can get really caught up in all these other things. And when I run, it reminds me exactly why I'm doing this, because I love the land so much, and I feel like it's my responsibility to be a good future ancestor, and that means caring for the land that I love in both my career but also in my passions.
Because running was a part of our ceremonies. Oftentimes, especially for the women's basket dance, it's preceded with a run, and the men would run prior to the women coming out to dance, and they would be recognized with some of the artifacts that the women wove, like a basket or a plaque of some sort. The belief is that if you came in first as a runner at that ceremony, then you really had the community at heart. So it's never about running for an individual purpose or an individual winning or a very personal thing. It was about community. And so if you came in first, the community looked at you as someone who ran for the whole people, for all the people. And that was very powerful. I think he just was part of that tradition. It was just something that was part of being Hopi.
And it's interesting because right now I'm going through my own struggle of a lot of change that's happening on campus. People have been giving me advice like, you know, you better start standing out. You better start speaking out. You know, you need to be out there. And they know it's not my style. And, you know, someone even said, you know, I know it's countercultural, but, you know, you just got to do it. And I really thought about that. And I've actually been thinking about it, that it's those kinds of things where, you know, you really have to think about how much, you know, you conform to those expectations and standards without losing your true self. I think running is one way that I just process some of that. I think about it.
I thought was super helpful, but I think some of the main challenges that I faced and the main differences that I saw running from back home compared to running at the U of A was just, and I think it's also a reflection of how our Native students feel when they enter into the institution, is this very individualistic framework. It's very competitive. It's about the time, you know, you need to hit this certain time, you need to be at this certain pace. And like, for example, one time running at the U of A, you know, we're out there, it's hot, and I stopped along the path for some water at a water fountain. And that was something that was not, I guess, was frowned upon. And I was told by the coach, you know, you need to, this is the female head coach at the time, was, you need to like keep going, and why are you stopping type of stuff. And it's like, I'm thirsty. And compared to back home, it's like when we're out there running and we get into maybe run past like a wash or a river, like right now how there's water in the river, we would play in it, you know, we would roll around and splash and have fun and then continue on running. And I think for me, the biggest difference was that it wasn't as fun anymore. It was very much like strategic and very, you have to be at the next level, the next level, the next level. I think that was tough for me. And also like.
All right. So I just wanted to play the stories from the beginning, but Lydia was a doctoral student at the time. She's actually got her PhD last year. And Dr. Nicholas is here sharing about Tiwanima and being a part of the Hopi tradition. Karen is an administrator, has been at the university for over 20 plus years. Many of us know her. And Tiffany ran at the collegiate level, along with Isaac, a Division I athlete. And so she was describing those differences between her home community and being at the university. So overall, like within the culture, folks, like there were some stories that I heard, which I'm going to show this here. The font is small, but that's okay because I'm actually still editing some of this. But I want you to see the spider web where all these stories come together. And within this spider web, we heard four stories here. But overall, with Tiwanima, Dr. Nicholas shared like how he ran in the Olympics And he was a very stellar athlete. And where there was one story, right, where he had missed the bus to one of the runs and he ran to the race, but then ended up winning the race, even though he missed the bus. And so, but for Timonima, it was never for the accolades. You know, he would sometimes forget his winnings or his medals, and people would have to give it to him. And one time I asked, well, now Dr. Lydia Jennings, I asked her, how many medals do you have? She's an avid runner. And so she said, it doesn't matter. And she reminded me of Timonima. Dr. Mom, I had asked her like why she runs and what does it serve in the academy? And she said she would not have got through the academy if it wasn't for running. So she's now a psychologist and one of the few Pueblo psychologists. And so all these different stories wove together about running. But overall, it formed this spider web that all of us are in it. So now when you're cleaning your house and you see a spider web, think of us. Think of the beauty of it. Think about how this all came together. But overall, I want to just share this poem that I wrote, and this encompasses what the findings are and the discussion is. But again, if you get emotional sickness, close your eyes. Okay, Indigenous sovereignty runners. It's been a long route, but we journeyed this marathon together. The marathon of finishing a degree, the marathon of education, the marathon of life. Who are Indigenous sovereignty runners? Indigenous undergraduate students and graduate students, staff, administrators, and faculty of the academy, Indigenous people in non-Native serving institutions. Indigenous sovereignty runners are messengers, scholars, Indigenous people who determine their own educational, personal, and professional pathways. Indigenous sovereignty runners are Indigenous people in the academy who use or have used running as a powerful means to navigate through educational spaces. Indigenous sovereignty runners come in all shapes and sizes, pray through their feet, have their community in their hearts, and they connect with the land and Mother Earth. They have cultural maps, they honor their families and ancestors, and Indigenous sovereignty runners are overcomers. Indigenous sovereignty runners are here for the long run. And this all relates back to the Pueblo Revolt of 1680. This is a very important mark within our Pueblo people and our culture. And this is, in this time, the Pueblo people strategically mapped out a revolt against the Spaniards that were coming up from Mexico. And in the Pueblo Revolt, there were two runners, or there's a lot of runners, but there was runners that took messages to the different villages to let them know that, you know, what the plans were and what was gonna happen. And this is one of America's first American Revolution in our country. Most people don't know that, but it's a part of our culture and it's a part of our history. And with that, the reason why I talked about revolt and education is because a revolt is a collective movement by a community. It's an experience of collective and self-determination. It's standing up for oneself and the community. It's challenging oppression and fighting for the preservation of life, advancing the goals of the community, and a demonstration of courage, bravery, and justice. And all the runners in this film embody that. And they are warriors of the academy and in their communities. And they embody sovereignty as we know it. They define themselves who they are as Indigenous people. They're a part of their larger community and their hearts are to serve the people. And running is a huge part of helping them navigate who they are, to help them process what's happening, whether it's toxicity in the academy or it's personal things like getting through COVID and dealing with the family members with that. But this is a story about people who remain in the academy, and not only remain, but thrive and bless So that's why I'm talking about generational blessings, that they bless other people through their work and their time and their dedication to one another and to our Indigenous youth. And so, so that's who the Indigenous Sovereignty Runners are. And so those who are watching, even if you don't run, it's okay. It doesn't matter your ability. If you're in education, you're an Indigenous Sovereignty Runner. So at this time, I just want to thank all the 20 scholarship entities to help me finish debt-free. Students who are watching, you better take a screenshot of this and go apply. But I just wanted to acknowledge that and take any questions as I gather myself here. are there any questions that came through? Questions. People in the room here can ask questions too. Doesn't have to just be online.
Anyone in the room, Mandy?
Anybody in the room?
Shout out, Rudy.
There are all of you.
Hi, Mandy. This is Eliza. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Oh my goodness. That was such a beautiful, powerful, sacred space you shared with us. I just want to say thank you. Thank you. And yeah, Mazgiratza, I was wondering if you can share with us a little more about the framework you're using that you developed. You shared it in the beginning with the different strands and just kind of highlight what some of those areas are and what that process was for you to develop it.
Yeah, so I would go back to the spider web here. I was looking high and low for a framework. Within education, sometimes it's really hard because it doesn't exist within our Indigenous community yet. And so with the framework here, I was thinking about Brave Boy's, how stories are theory. The first like three paragraphs of his article, I think, are the most powerful because he demonstrates how you turn stories into theory. And then literally, I would just sit with this whiteboard. I'm like, what am I doing? How did I create this? And it's this Indigenous map that has to turn into paper, and from my mind to paper. And so, and when I was just thinking, like, Dr. Amanda Tachini, you look at her dissertation, she used the metaphor of weaving a rug. And so it's kind of the same thing, like it's these strands that come together to weave something together. And so when I was thinking about this process, it was a similar thing. It was like the strand, but it's a spider web. My grandma's teasing me because she was like, what's in Charlotte's web? What does Charlotte's web spell within her web? And so I think my grandma just created a framework for herself. But so it really was just sitting down and thinking about our culture, like thinking about who are our people? What have they told us? And why have they told us this? And so then that's when these things start to strand together. And Kayleen helped me articulate this. Even with this kitchen table effect, oh my gosh, I went on this wild adventure looking at kitchen tables in the literature. and so there's a lot there within the Latinx community. There's testimonials where people come together and share their stories, but they come together with this common bond of being oppressed and being discriminated and sharing those stories and finding healing in that. So that's kind of the same concept. You're coming together, you're talking about something that means something to you. Also within the Black feminist movement, there was this printing press called the Kitchen Table. I cannot remember the second part of it, but it was a printing press created by Black feminists. And they came together, it was like in the 1980s, kind of off the cusp of the women's movement in the 1970s. But these Black women came together and said that our voices aren't being heard. And so they talked about the kitchen table, how it's a form of grassroots for Black communities, how it's a form of initiation where young girls are there and they come on and come alongside the women and they become women. So there was a lot of different things in different fields that I saw. I was like, wow, it's all very similar, but I still felt that it still didn't capture what I was trying to communicate here. So that's why I created this model. There's also another one too, where this these non-Indigenous people researchers had interviewed about 200 Indigenous people, and their conversations had ended up at the table. So it was cool because I was like, oh yeah, like the kitchen table, right? Like feast days, right? When you come together and it's just this table of food, right? You come together and you share these stories. So that's how I had to dig deep to figure out, like, what have I learned from my family and how can I articulate this in the academy? So let's see, kind of some examples.
Mandy?
Yeah.
Nora and Ray mentioned that it's a kitchen table press.
Yes, kitchen table press. Thank you, Nora. Shout out to you.
And Ray. Also, Saima, your mentee has a question. Why did you choose to incorporate mentoring, and what role did it play in your career, your process of going through school?
Oh, Saima and Sandimka, I really love you too. They're two young people in Hopi, and the reason why I mentor, the runners here are all mentors to a lot of different communities, and mentorship is huge. You know, when you look at these different runners here and you think about who they represent and their communities, even Lydia herself, if you follow her, a soil nerd, I forget, on Twitter, she has like a following of like 5,000 people. But it has to be about the community. That's the only way that we're going to be able to survive as a people. And mentorship is a powerful way to bring up the next, you know, bring up your brothers and sisters. You know, like when I was writing this dissertation, my little brothers and sisters, my brother and sister, Amari and Major, they would call me almost every day. And I would just put them up. They're on their Facebook Messenger. And I would just put them up. I'm like, oh, I'm doing my homework. And they're like, I'm like, do you want me to hang up on you, or do you want to keep, just stay on? They're like, stay on, stay on. They're like coloring, you know, and doing like arts and crafts, but I'm here writing. You know, they were a part of me to help. They were with me in this journey to write, because it's showing them I'm doing my homework. My homework, right? But it's demonstrating to them, oh, okay, I'm in college, right? That word college is a plant, you know, seed, you know? So I really appreciate you, Saima, and I love you and your sister so much, and you guys inspire me. So I got about 5 more minutes.
Mandy, I know you do a lot of work with youth and mentorship, as was just mentioned, through Project SOAR. If you had a chance to kind of address these the middle school students, high school students, that oftentimes that program, your program works with, what would you tell them about the race?
I leave it right here on this picture of these young kids over at Havasupai. They're people of the blue-green water. You ever have a chance to go there? Man, that's a sight to be in their community. With these young people, I want them to know, Rudy, as you've taught me how to apply for scholarships, that they can go to school for free and have it all covered. Because college can be very intimidating. But I feel like with this modality, my mom had called it one time an unorthodox dissertation, because there's a full-length film, and then this will be coming soon. It's kind of, I feel like it's like you know, Jurassic Park, you have all the cool movies, then you have the book, you know, it's kind of like that. It's cool because it's an accessible way to communicate. It's a long way to communicate. It takes a lot of time. But I think that wanting young people to know that you can do it, like that there are scholarships to help pay for you to go to college, and knowing that we come from this rich history of our ancestors. Out of the runners that were here, Karen's gonna get her PhD soon. My mom got her dissertation done a couple years ago. Tiffany Sorrell finished her dissertation, Lydia finished her dissertation, and now I'm finishing mine. That's just within this set of runners. Alejandro was working here at the institution. Jesse's working for his tribal community. Alpha Joy is graduating from Columbia University in New York City from the master's program. Power, yeah, these powerhouse folks. I should make a part two, not a dissertation, but a part two video. Karen.
So Mandy, you've had opportunities to travel abroad. I'm just wondering how those experiences inspired your thinking in terms of, I think, understanding that we're more the same than we are different. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, what was really surprising out of some of those experiences that, you know, was sort of maybe helping you shape another level of awareness and understanding about Indigenous peoples?
So going abroad, I went to Australia, New Zealand a few times. And, you know, it's interesting when you talk within our country, we talk about blood quantum. Abroad, I feel like that conversation is absent. Like you just are, like Maori, or you just are Aboriginal from your different, they call it mob, M-O-B, the different mobs. Like you just are. And if you listen within the conversations, like a gathering, sometimes you'll hear students say like, oh, like I'm part Navajo and I'm part, or I'm half Navajo and part Apache, or like, oh, I'm a quarter Laguna and a quarter Acoma and a quarter San Ildefonso and a quarter Hispanic. One of my uncles would say like, man, that was a good powwow. But you know, there's like these fractions, right? Like these fractions. And within our brothers and sisters abroad, they just are when they communicate. It's fascinating. That's one of the biggest differences I saw. Another fact too with the kitchen table effect, I also found an article about the Maori community. There was a researcher that he's an Indigenous researcher in New Zealand, and he talked about like when you work with Maori people, there's very very beautiful protocols that you do, kind of like what we did today. Like they open up usually with a song and a greeting, and then it becomes like less formal. And so when I was thinking about the kitchen table effect, like this author was talking about how that happened, it was very formal, but then the conversations would always end at the kitchen table. And I knew because of the ceremonial welcomings that we had there, like what that looked like from the Maori tradition. And so that helped me contextualize like, oh, I know what it means to go from formal to informal within that Maori context that I put in my dissertation for the kitchen table.
Hello?
Yes.
Hi, it's Luann Leonard here on Hopi. Hi, Manny. I'm so proud of you. And I just wanted to know, how do you envision your work being used by the frontline education workers out here on the reservations as they work with our kids? Wow. What would be your ideal way of them using your research and models? Thank you.
I think it's the video. You start first with the video, you go find one of those runners that resonates with you. We got Hopi, we got two Hopi representatives, Dr. Nicholas and Tiwonima. You start there, you know, like look at their segments and maybe just play 5 minutes of it and ask the students, what do you see? What do you think? When you see this picture of Tiwonima, what comes to your mind? You know, when you ask them that, you can come up with all kinds of cool activities. So the video for young people, I think, is a great way to start. And I think that with the branding, I was very intentional with the branding to hire Kayleen, because I think this can also turn, I think of it as I think kind of slipped here, of like a movement, that it's like there's these stickers or these t-shirts that could be made that like what the representation of this is. So I think that's on the future, but I think that the video for young people would be a very great tool, as well as the model. Dr. Sean Secretario also created a well-being model, and this is also a springboard from that. You can have them and sit down, like, and ask them, what helps you in this time? Like, what resources or what... who helps you get through today? You know, like, so you can have them create their own well-being model. So that's also a really cool way to have them design their own strands to make them make their own spider web.
Andy?
Yep.
There's a viewer out there.
This will be our last question.
Okay, this is our last question.
They've had their hand up for a while.
Okay, go ahead.
So Marvin Trujillo, their hand is up.
Hey, good afternoon, sis. This is Kutiatia to the Koikyu and I say, Opa Tawash Tawash. Hello?
Hello.
Oh, sis, again, this is Marvin Trujillo Jr. from the Pueblo of Laguna, Secretary. I just want to commend you on your accomplishments. And I just want to let you know that you know, as far as the governor, the council, we express our sincere appreciation for your representation of our Pueblo, Pueblo of Laguna. Some of the things that you mentioned, you know, you talked about runners. Some of the runners that I thought about here in Laguna, you know, we had Mr. Tony Riley from the village of Laguna. We also had Ms. Lucero from the village of Masita. And, you know, a lot of the things that you said today really brought a lot of good things in resonance as far as how a lot of these things go into our education. I just want to tell you that we're proud of you. You know, keep up your good work and gume te kuiakstrus and you know, stay happy. And again, we send all of regards to you and your family. So I just wanted to make those comments.
Thank you. Appreciate that. Thank you. Oh, man, what an adventure. So I gotta go. I guess I'm on court trial, as my grandma said. It's funny because my mom was, my grandma's like, what is it called that we're going to? It sounds like a court trial. I was like, a dissertation defense? She's like, yeah. So I guess I'm on trial. So I have to go meet with my committee. But please, if you can, stay on because I'd love to hear just feedback. Just talk. You know, I want to hear what you think about this, really. And we'll maybe back here by 3:50. Please come back, or if you want to sign back on, the president of the not the United States, the university will come. So we'll see you soon. Please send out. Charlinda are going to facilitate this part. Thank you.
Good job, Samaku.
I'm not sure. So I don't use any of the functions on the computer.
Were you just?
She wants me to moderate the. Yeah, the discussion in the room. Okay. So at this portion, you know, while Mandy's gone, she's just invited us to chat. So I know there's been a lot of activity in the chat. And so we just invite you to unmute yourself and just share feedback and also just responses to her presentation. It was powerful. I had to stop myself a couple of times from crying. Just so beautiful, but we'd love to hear from those of you who are still on and who would like to share your thoughts about her presentation. And also too, she wants to revisit your comments later. So please jump on in and just participate with us as we wait for her to come back.
Hi. Oh, hold on. Okay, yeah, to everyone. This is Alessandra Uintilly. I just wanted to leave a quick message here and start a conversation. I'm proud of you, Amanda. You did a great job. I'm thankful for you exploring this in your dissertation. You mentioned it. I was following it on Facebook, but I didn't get to see, you know, where it was leading you. And seeing these frameworks, these conceptual frameworks that are introduced in your dissertation is profounding as an educator. So thank you, Amanda, for exploring this and putting this together. I think one of the ideas that came to mind as I was listening to Amanda and her dissertation journey and her explanation of how you know, everything came together. She felt like she was working backwards. And sometimes that's how a lot of us feel, like we're working backwards or we're working with too much. And sometimes I always felt like that was just being a female, always multitasking or pulling in different ideas from different areas. But, you know, the more I got older, the more I realized that's a holistic thinker. And seeing her, you know, the web design of that conceptual thinking of things coming in its own time and us making our own understanding of it was very inspiring for me to see in that conceptual framework. For me, it makes a lot of sense because I'm rooted in my tradition and my culture. My question going forward to not only Amanda, but to all the educators in here, was I wanted to know if there was, or if you know, those of you who have been involved or have just even explored this with the youth that you've been working with, is there any generational differences about running and cultural teachings? I know she's working at a generation that's college level, but I always wonder about the high school, the middle school, you know, the K-8. Is there generational differences? Does the conversation have to change to continue this type of cultural preservation? Thank you. That was my question.
So, yeah, thank you. And also, Ms. Utili, thank you so much for coming to our first virtual youth and family gathering. It's so important to also be involved with the work of Native SOAR and also other Native serving programming. So thank you so much for participating with that. I think your question is powerful and important. And I do hope that she responds with a bunch of feedback, but also since you sort of referenced other educators here in the space, I mean, I think it'd be great to open it up to those of you who want to respond to that question. And until someone does, I can say that one thing that has been of ongoing importance to Mandy is just that issue of accessibility. For those of you who know her from Facebook and Instagram and Twitter and now TikTok, you know that a lot of what she does is accessible to the community, and it's definitely with her heart for the youth, right? So she's always interested in sharing stories that not only can inspire, but also that can freely give knowledge, right? And share knowledge in ways that we would if we were in person, and also too in ways that we would if we were within our communities back home. And so I think it's really awesome that she presents so much of her work in that way. So it's not surprising that her dissertation started with a movie and with a community event. And then it kind of morphed into additional promotion, right? With t-shirts and with stickers. And also even now, you know, she's talking about following up with books and other volumes. So that is not surprising to someone whose heart is with and on the community at all times. So I do think it's important that she continues with the accessibility and also too in inviting others into the work that she's created.
Yes, definitely. I like that she uses those venues where the youth are at, grabbing their attention and their interest in those platforms. And I kind of feel like that's the direction of a lot of this cultural preservation these days. I mean, with her modeling that in our community. So thank you, Amanda. Thank you, guys. Thank you to all the educators there, former alumni, former U of A Wildcat from back in the day. So I saw some familiar names and faces pop up in the participation room, and Amanda was somebody that I met leaving the U of A, so I got to see her the full last year as Miss Native U of A. So I've been following you, Amanda, and I'm very proud of you, and thank you. Continue to inspire the youth.
Awesome. And thank you so much for being an avid follower of all of our social media platforms for Native SOAR.
And this is Simona. I'm actually the parent of Soima Maho and Sanapga Maho. And she's a mentor to both of my students. And Amanda does allow these students to express culture within her mentoring. She tries to incorporate it by stating like, okay, because both my children are, were not born on the reservation, but they're being raised out here right now. And one of the key questions she's always asking them, okay, how can you go back to the elders and ask them questions? Or how can you, because around in Hopi, uncle or a taha plays a very prominent role. So she asked them, well, how can you go to your grandpa or your uncle and ask them for how to do things, guidance, so on and so forth. And so really a lot of these things are important, and Amanda embraces that. She encourages children to learn as much as possible, learn the language, and a lot of the language preservation, a lot of the teachings, learnings, all of that is gonna all fall back on us as parents, grandparents, you know, uncles, aunts, and community members within our own respective reservations, villages, and tribes as to how are we gonna do that? How are we gonna play that key role to keep our language, traditions, culture going and thriving? And, you know, thankfully I'm growing up in a very cultural rich family where my children get those teachings. But, you know, more recent, like within 20 years ago, you know, Emery Sikekwapdiwa, the late Emery Sikekwapdiwa, who was also a professor there at U of A, he developed the dictionary for Hopi. And that also plays a key role. You know, Hopi was never really a written language until that point on. So now they're utilizing that dictionary now within the classrooms. And so I guess it starts from the day you're born, incorporating that knowledge, incorporating that language so that your child can, or the children can and will learn things as they grow along in life. And, you know, being Native, you never stop learning. The learning is every day you grab something, you learn something. It can be as simple as something as asking, what does this mean? Or why do we do things this certain way? Without, you know, because sometimes it's always just like, do it this way, but you don't understand why until you actually ask. And there's always a process to everything, especially culturally. You know, you don't just do things out of the way you want to, you know, something as simple as why you plant the seed the way that you do, like the corn, why we have to space it out, why different things, all the different processes. So those are things I think are going to fall back really on us as community members, as preserving that and embracing it. I mean, there's only so much that the academia can do for us, but really it falls back on us as to how we're going to preserve that. Thank you.
Yeah, I think your comment really relates to the issues of sovereignty, especially concerning self-education, just how much all of that is really part of what the community already does. And so I think it's really amazing that she incorporated that portion of tribal crit into her work, because I think you're exactly right. Like, while there's work that we can do here in the academy, a lot of the work that we value most is already happening within our tribal communities and within our own peoples. And so really what she's done here is merged the two in a way that I think is really powerful and beautiful. But as I'm talking here, I'm looking at your screen. Is that the sticker that was made for the attendees?
No, let me see. I might have one of them. Let me see. I have to look. Once I pull it up, I can pull one of the stickers up for you, and then I can change it to that specific background. I'll pull up. This is a different sticker that Saima actually made. There's the Roadrunner and the turkey, and I'll bring up both of them. I'll quickly make that filter in the back, and you guys will both get a preview of what it is and what it looks like.
Awesome. I'm so excited about those stickers. Yeah, just having them as a part of Native SOAR this past semester has been really, really, really special. A couple of times Mandy has had the opportunity to play videos of her sessions with them in the class. And so not only is she doing her best to impact and encourage them, but also she shares the reciprocity there, like where the students actually, your kids, have really impacted her and have caused her to grow as a mentor, and also have been an example for our students. You know, I'll never forget where Mandy brought up the story about how Simon was going to make those stickers and wants to be an entrepreneur and wants to really promote the artwork. And, you know, our students were asking, wait a minute, how old is he? You know, and all of these undergrads were so impressed with just the desire to create and to be out there with artwork. And so there's the piece I think that you're referring to. Beautiful. So yeah, absolutely an encouragement to all of us, and especially the undergraduates that we get to work with in the classroom space. Thank you for sharing those.
So this one is actually her Roadrunner sticker in there. You can see that there's a lot of prayer designs in there. And I think when Seema was creating this specific design, he talked about that. It's like when you're going on these journeys, you always have a lot of prayer with you. You always think good, positive thoughts. And that's pretty much what's in there. You know, the going through the journey, your journey through life. So all that is incorporated in that, in this one. This is a his version of a Roadrunner. I'll pull up the turkey design has more of a Pueblo type of feel to it. So I can pull that one up. That one's the full color.
So as Mandy had mentioned before she headed out in the room, she wanted to get some feedback as well in the comments. So was there anything in terms of her explanation that you would like her to further explain more, or would want more information? Just because I know she wants her dissertation to be accessible to a diverse audience. So for those of you who are in the higher education field, is there more information that you would want from her to expand on?
Hi, Sharon. This is Hasmin. How are you? Can you hear me? I'm just making sure you guys can hear me. Great. Well, I'm just so proud of Mandy and a lot of your fellow peers that we went to school together. I've known Mandy for about 15 years, so it's just a pleasure to be able to see her, you know, do this. This is actually my first dissertation that I ever attend. I've never really gotten the opportunity to go to one. So I just, as a fellow scholar, I'm currently in my master's program here at the U of A in public health. I guess I consider myself now an Indigenous runner after hearing her presentation, hopefully one of many, you know, and it's just inspiring to see Mandy do this. And I know Shari, you've done it too, and other of my peers that, you know, we go way back. So I just had a question, the grandma's table metaphor that Mandy used. I think that's very powerful in many ways. And I think specifically Native cultures definitely can have a great impact as it translates to academia. But I think it could actually translate to other cultures too. And I know Mandy's had a heart for kind of like Indigenous global perspectives. And so I would just be interested on hearing more about the applicability of how that could, you know, be relatable to other Indigenous cultures, you know, globally. And so I don't know, I think it's worth exploring. I know there's other cultures that that would really resonate with as well. So thank you guys.
Good. That's really good feedback, Hasmin. And also too, I felt deeply encouraged because I am not a runner either. And after hearing this, I was so encouraged to start, but also to see myself in that way and to conceptualize the work that we do here in that way as well. So thanks for bringing that up, and we'll certainly share your feedback, because I think you're right. There is sort of a a global perspective here, where that particular part of her framework can be shared with others and used with others. Like I saw in the chat earlier that Melody had mentioned that she can't wait to cite that model in future work. So I love how it's already bubbling up in conversation and how we can look forward to seeing that in the years to come. So yeah, thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. I can't help but think how Mandy's journey through the University of Arizona, her academic journey, her professional development, her personal growth, really is something that the institution should think about. Because the kind of scholarship and thinking she's engaged in is really what I've been waiting for. And as somebody who's been feeling really busy at work and not attending the meetings that come across my inbox with the Indigenous community, I can tell you I feel warm all the time from the incredible energy that's going on right now in the Indigenous community. It's powerful without even my attendance, just the sheer prolific intensity and range of issues that you all are taking on. So I feel like 2021, and I mean, it's up to us as a community to decide going forward if we're going to have a glass half full or glass half empty kind of attitude. And I think Mandy has willed her way forward. This sacred space we've all been in today with so many people, I'm so beyond moved. But so excited that this kind of work she's produced has touched all of us so deeply in multiple ways. So at the institutional level, there's a lot to be proud of in the sense that with the support she did get and with the community that has been around her, that Mandy is now showing us what scholarship can look like moving forward. So this is to say, I mean, I think we've got work to do as an institution, something to be proud of, some stuff to reflect on, but I think there's a lot of lessons here about what the future can look like in terms of how we teach in the future, the generations that are coming now, how we support them, the sorts of policies that we have. There's a lot to learn. Thank you. I'm just beyond blown away.
How are we, Nora? Thank you so much for sharing your content or your comments. I will say that this is actually a reflection of exactly what you're talking about, in that Mandy has always made it a point to honor those who have provided support for her. And so there are so many people, you know, for those of you who are not familiar with the U of A community, there are so many institutional leaders in this space. It's amazing. There were others here earlier. I think the top number of participants was over 140 at one point. But it's really miraculous in that not only has she found support by so many throughout the institutional community, but she's maintained contact and has put others in touch with that support. And I think that's really important because in some ways, it's rewarding, right, to see, like, you know, you're out there, those of you who are doing this work on the day-to-day, on the front lines with students, fighting for students, right, supporting students, you can see how this really not only impacted her educational journey, but also, too, her success within the institution. It's so powerful, and so in the same way that you know, we recognize all the hard work that she's done. I know that she would be really proud to say that a lot of you have contributed to that work. And so, I mean, I know she's going to say this many, many times over, but it's true. She's very grateful for the support that so many of you have already given to her and have already provided in the years past and also in the years moving forward. So thank you so much, Nora, and thank you for all the other institutional leaders out there that are really contributing to this work every single day with our students. And speaking of which, I know Amanda's here too as well. Amanda, if you wouldn't mind participating or unmuting yourself, I'm sure she would love to hear your comments. I know that you wrote a lot in the chat, but just kind of bringing this whole thing first full circle with Native Soar, I'm sure she would love to hear from you as well. If you're there. That's okay.
I think one thing that I really appreciate about Mandy's research. Oh,
there she is,
Dr. Chichini.
Hi, everybody. This has just been so wonderful. I'm here actually with my daughter, Coral. She's sitting back here by me. But just so amazed at the incredible work that Mandy has created. I'm just like, seriously, the indigenous methodology, I would love for her to think about that, and because I think many Native scholars are thinking about how to assert Indigenous methodology, particularly when you're thinking like, maybe I didn't grow up in my homelands, or I don't know my language, when we're struggling over who we are still due to colonization. I feel like for her to really think about just the conceptualization of kitchen table, we can all relate to that grandmother's kitchen table and how that's a way of really building upon methods. So I love that about her work, and I love the spider web thinking too. I can't wait to just dig in and read her dissertation. And so just really wonderful. Just so many accolades of you all doing amazing work with Native Soar. I was chanting in there because in a lot of ways, you know, many of us have known many of you since you're a freshman back in the day with the first year scholars program, which is really rooted in Indigenous knowledge systems. And then with the Native Soar, again, rooted in Indigenous knowledge systems. So I'm just thinking about all the ways that these programs, these institutional programs have supported and created PhD, master's, bachelor degrees, Native people. And so it's just really wonderful to see and be a part of all of that. So I can't wait to hear the announcement of Dr. Cheromiah, like many of y'all. So we're just waiting here, Coral and I, for that time. But I'm just so happy to be a part of this with everybody. It's good to see familiar faces too, a lot of you.
So actually, if you were part of Native Soar as a mentee or a mentor, put it in the chat. Tell us what year you came through.
Even first year scholars program, I think that has a lot of longevity too.
That's awesome.
Yes, and so one thing that I really appreciate about Mandy's dissertation is that space to be vulnerable, as she opened up, letting us know that it's okay to cry and have those emotions. And I think within academia, we often don't show those emotions. And throughout her work, you see it not only in her writing, but the photography she's taking, the videos that she's recording, the relationships that she's building. And so definitely, I think she's taking that path for future scholars to allow vulnerability within our writing.
I like to add to that. I think that when she does continue presenting this, and I hope she does share this, you know, now that it's packaged in her dissertation, that she continues to share this with educators, is that, you know, historically education has not been positive for Indigenous people. So to be that person to come in front of cultures and say that no longer the outlook, we need to change our mindset and use it to get to where we want to be, to make our decisions on how to use, you know, education and this journey to do what we want to do, which is going to be some sort of cultural preservation, because we're going to still be there. We're going to still have a voice to share out there in the world. So I like that she says that, and she starts with that, because
I mean, we're all academically inclined here because we work in the education field, but for her to go out, step outside of this audience and share her story, there's going to be a lot of feelings in that room. And her, you know, representing those children in boarding school with that haircut, you know, it's just a visual representation of that historical trauma that can change with her. You know, she's going to be wearing a doctoral cap. and that visual just, she's changing perceptions. and it's so amazing to see that. And I like that she, you know, she starts with that and she continues to share that with people as she continues to share the story. Thank you, guys.
Yeah, that's beautiful. You know, I know that when she created the film, and, you know, she shared a lot about this, but that really was birthed out of just a need to cope with things and also to process trauma, you know, from the past. And so that original project with the film was really just a coping method, you know, that she employed at the time just out of pure necessity. But I really think it is incredible how that initial work then transformed into the work that she does every day in the academy. And I do think that her story contained within that film is going to impact a lot of people. I know that it already has. I think it's really special that she has always been someone who's been willing to share her true experience with others in the way that she shares, you know, what's happened in her life. But also too, she also shares how she's been able to find overcoming, you know, and how she's able to find victory in so many things. And I think that's really special because as she said earlier in her presentation, you don't find that very often in the academy. I mean, I think a lot of times we're taught to act as though nothing's going on, or even now in the midst of the pandemic, and also too within social and racial uprising, a lot of people have just been coming to this space and just kind of going on as though nothing's happened. And so I love how her work counters that, right? Her approach counters that, where she recognizes, no, there's a lot of things that are going on right now that have affected a lot of our well-being, a lot of our mental health, right? And that we need to acknowledge those things. And not only do we need to face those things, but also that we can do that as community, that we can do that together. So I really do think it's an example of having that approach, especially in this space that, again, kind of teaches you to sort of suck it up or sort of pretend like it's not happening, right? But I think that this comes right in the face of that, and I really do appreciate that.
And I see on the chat that Dr. Chris Nelson, do you have a question for Mandy, or do you have any feedback?
Can you all hear me?
Yes.
Sorry, if my Wi-Fi might cut out a little bit, I apologize, but it's just great to see everyone on this screen. For those of you, my name is Chris Nelson. I've had the honor to work with Mandy since she's joined the Early Academic Outreach as the NACEP coordinator. I was also coordinating with that alongside her when I was at the U of A. And we're also Laguna as well, so we shared that. We've had a lot of special times together, and I just am so proud of her to be at this point. As Amanda Ciccini had mentioned earlier, you know, the blending of Indigenous methodologies, I was talking to my partner, Johnny, and just saying that I felt like her work is just such a great representation of the journey and the amount of progress that can be made in research in such a short period of time. Because going through the same program and just planting those seeds with faculty and being able to see what is really possible whenever we're engaging in research. And I just am looking so much forward to seeing other scholars as they kind of move through this, and also being part of the U of A alumni, and for her being three times over is also a real testament to how great the University of Arizona has supported their Native students. And I think for myself, I think everything that all the comments that people are making, then also conceptually just pushing her to continue sharing this with the community. I think that's one thing that I would really hope that she does, is to continue seeing this as an avenue of not just what is happening at the university level, but really giving power to our communities and showing that we do have that we've always had the knowledge and the ability to navigate life in a very meaningful and spiritual way. I also find it really powerful too, because you mentioned Sean Secatero's American Indian Wellbeing Model, and that was something that we kind of blended together whenever we were starting to conceptually develop NACEP, and I just thought that was really awesome to kind of see that come full circle. So that's all I have to say.
That framework is still alive and well in NACEP. So we do think we honor those foundational beginnings, and also to the work that you've gone on to do, Chris. So thank you so much for being part of that amazing cohort of Indigenous scholars that a lot of us look up to and still look up to. So I do see that there's also Aura, right, that you want to go ahead and share your comment if you want to. Hey, good to see you,
Aura. Hi, good to see you, Felice. It's been a while. So I just wanted to echo a lot of, the rest of the commenters and the community here about the work that Mandy has done. And really, I just really am impressed by her perseverance and her creativity and her indigenuity. The models that she's created are really Indigenous models, right? And they're based in her culture and her community. And I just want her to realize how unique and how special that really is. There are other people who've said that higher education hasn't been a place for Indigenous peoples. And to be able to create something through her own lived experiences, through her cultural knowledge, the cultural knowledge of other people that have crossed paths with her, is really amazing. And I think it really speaks to just how innovative she is. And I really hope she continues down the path that she is, with this sort of mixed methods and multimedia sort of approach that she takes, because we have very different sort of learning styles within our different Indigenous cultures. And she, in my mind, her research and the work that she's completed here is that turning point for us as Indigenous scholars. And she's embodying exactly what we've been going to school for all of these years, is to get to this point where we are able to really leverage our cultural knowledge and our education in a way that really helps our people and our communities. And that touches my heart. It makes me really proud. It just makes me really proud of the work that she's done and her perseverance in keeping that up. Our ancestors have prayed for many years for this moment to happen, so that we can go back to her Indigenous knowledge. And she was able to pull that together and to provide that, to share that with us. And I just hope that, all of these students who are on their way through master's programs and into doctoral programs see that there is a way, there is a pathway to engage with our own knowledge in a way that benefits our own people.
And, you know, I just want to tell her how proud I am of her and just how impressed I am of her. And, you know, welcome to this world, Dr. Cheromiah. I'm so happy and just really proud and really blessed, I feel, to have crossed paths with her. She's really motivated me to do a lot for our students here at NAU and in our community, within my own communities. And so from the bottom of my heart, you know, I just want to say,
awesome. Thank you, Aura. Thank you, Amanda.
Thank you.
Amanda, thank you for sharing your indigenuity.
I'm a little creative that way. So up here at NAU, we have our Indigijacks. So we just kind of roll with that. So indigenuity.
Perfect. Yeah, well, to pass that on, she'll give you credit. Well, yeah, that's exactly how she rolls, right? Like all of us who have had a friendship relationship with her know that she is an endless source of creativity, innovation. I mean, she approaches things in new ways. And I think that that's also been a part of her success here, not only as a practitioner, but also in the classroom space and certainly now with her research. Yeah, we love it. Even if you've played categories with this woman, you know, she's an out of the box thinker and she comes up with things that you could never come up with. So it's awesome. But thank you so much, Aura. Yeah, I'm excited to see what else comes.
So we have about probably 10 more minutes before she comes back into the room. So please let us know if you have any comments, suggestions, recommendations. I know we see Debbie, you have your hand raised.
Yeah, I know a lot of people have had to go back to work probably, but I just had to jump in here. And one of the things about Amanda too is, and I remember back when we were talking to her about when you're gonna get your PhD. And several of you, like, you know, I've seen people like, back when you were in F, you know, first year scholars and all that. I mean, I started working at the U of A 22 years ago. I retired 6 years ago, but I miss this community so much. I mean, it's enriched my life hugely, just knowing all of you and enlarging my worldview. I just wanted to mention too, besides the running, connecting to the academic journey, there's also the art. And I also felt a little bit more of a connection with Amanda too, because I'm also a photographer, and the way that she used her photography and her movie making and stuff in the dissertation, I think it's fabulous, because obviously art is a huge part of Native culture also. So I thought that was awesome. And I'm just like so psyched to see so many of you out there that I used to work with. And I'm a hugger, so I'm just dying here, not having been able to hug anybody for a year and a half. And but yeah, I just had to say hi and congratulations and good luck on those of you still on the journey. And I wish I could say something in another language, but it's just French and that probably won't work here.
Awesome. Well, Debbie, we definitely appreciate the work that you did here at the U of A. I know a lot of us remember all of the convocation ceremonies, right? Where everybody would always include a Debbie Golden Davis shout out. So much for the work and for your legacy here at the U of A. We certainly miss you.
I miss you too. I had to leave for sanity reasons.
Understandable.
Yeah.
So Kia, I see your hand is up too. Go ahead and hop on with your comment or question.
All right, sweet. Thanks, Felice. So I don't know why, but earlier I kind of got scared and really nervous because there's a lot of people on the Zoom, but I want to hop back on and like tell everybody here that prayer that I said earlier, I made with my dad, and it's for Mandy and everybody who was on the Zoom for her education and for everybody to continue that for being here today. It's like super grateful and super amazing to hear that, and to have that be made for this special occasion was what the intent was.
and meeting Mandy, we met like her, we were our a study abroad success story along with other people on here like Mandy, Aura, Ernessa, Felice. That's everybody can see right now, but we met then and we were actually related through clan, through our Turkey clan. She's out from Laguna, but I'm here from Zuni. But we're our relations are still close together. We're still connected that way. And to see her through an educational journey like that has been super amazing and super inspiring, especially as a Pueblo woman. I don't think in my journey in education, I've seen a fellow Pueblo woman enter these higher spaces of education, and her being so influential and phenomenal. Her voice is super powerful and so strong. And it really inspired me as a Pueblo woman to finish my degree and look forward into higher education in different spaces and bring that, currently I'm back in home in Zuni right now, and bring that to my community and making sure that everything she's inspired in her research moves forward and moves along, because it's in our blood to be resilient. It's in our nature to be in these places. It's not in our nature to be in these places. We're not welcomed here, but we find these places. We bring our plaza chair. We sit it down and we're like, okay, what do we need to get done? And Mandy is truly that person to be and lead that thing and just be a part of those next generation of leaders, because she's in the area to inspire. And I'm just super thankful that she's in my life and that she's on this academic road and journey, and now going soon to be Dr. Amanda Cheromiah, another Pueblo woman with an advanced degree. She is our Indigenous success story. We're here to support her, and I'm super proud of her and everything she said, like academically, with everything she's ever done. It's super inspiring and just like so happy to be here on this Zoom and everybody here making that community, making all your comments. It's very beautiful and amazing to see this type of support. So I just want to extend my thank you to everybody here, and thanks for having me on this space while we're indigenizing the Zoom. Or it's got all the fancy terminology. just here, but Elaka, thank you for having me speak, and I know that we're going to continue following her journey and being in these places and spaces together.
Awesome. Kia, I'm so glad that you hopped on and said what you said, because it's true, sometimes these spaces are intimidating, right? Like we, I think, have come up in this space where it's normalized, right, to recognize hierarchy or to recognize status. And so I love that this disrupts all of that.
Mm-hmm.
Appearing in these ways authentically and appearing in these ways, you know, where we are honoring one another as fellow members of community is completely, it just supports the work that she's doing. And also too, it's encouraging for us to keep moving that way, because that is who we are. You know, mm-hmm. We don't have to change, or we don't have to morph to fit the academy, but rather we can be our authentic and unapologetically Indigenous selves, right, in these spaces. So thank you so much for coming on and for sharing all that you did. She's gonna love hearing this, I know it. And also big shout out to you for helping her with her clothes, right, when she was getting ready for her big photo shoot. So I know she really appreciated you having come down here and helped her with that. So big thank you, and it's good to see you again.
You too.
I think one thing that I thought about too, that she could put in her dissertation, is also how does she indigenize the dissertation defense process. And so I think she could definitely pave that way for future students who are going to be presenting, and how they could move beyond just doing a PowerPoint presentation. So thank you for mentioning that, because that sparked my mind right now. So we have about 6 minutes, hopefully they'll come back in the room. Possibly if we could take a break, so that way folks can go to the restroom, go get some water, coffee, do whatever you need to do before she comes back into the room. But we'll take a break, and then we'll come back in 5-6 minutes.
All right. Thank you all of you for coming and participating. I'm just so honored to be the first to recognize and introduce Dr. Amanda Cheromiah. Passed her dissertation defense with some revisions that will continue to sharpen her work. But as the committee encouraged her, this is just the first step of a lot of important advocacy work to come. So yeah, the marathon, she's crossed the finish line. And I don't think this is her last marathon. So congratulations, Dr. Cheromiah. Oh.
Oh, yeah. Well, Manny, congratulations. That's a lot of work, and I'm very, very proud of you and happy for you. It's an incredible day. I started my day out this morning with commencement for medical students in Phoenix, and sort of midday, get to come in and be part of your celebration. So I'm so impressed with everything that you've been able to accomplish during your time at the U of A, particularly through your role with Native SOAR. And I just personally want to thank you for helping me grow and all the wisdom that you've imparted to me and the guidance that you've given me. So I know there are many other people who want to speak today, but I just appreciate you thinking to invite me. I've never been to any other PhD defense at the University of Arizona in 4 years, so I want to go to more. I used to go to them all the time at Stanford. So congratulations. I'm very, very happy for you and very proud of you.
Thank you, Dr. Evans. I appreciate you. Thank you for coming.
Of course. I wish you were in person.
I know.
Sorry. The only room could fit 12, and you were number 13 on the list. Thank you for coming.
Thank you, Dr. Robbins.
Congratulations.
Thank you so much. And I know there are so many, I see all the stream of chats and congratulations, and we'll give you all an opportunity to share anything towards the end. We also have a surprise for Mandy.
Oh.
Dr. Nichols?
In Pueblo culture, I've always seen in my years of growing up on Hopi that when a female accomplished something of much importance for our community, I always saw them enfold her in the shawl. So this is the traditional hoodie happening on the University of Arizona campus for Dr. Amanda Cheromiah.
Oh, thank you.
I'm gonna wear my pink dress today. Awesome. Well, we figured it would be cool to do the hoodie here. Dr. Lee can't come because of COVID issues. But we figured that it would be such a blessing to do this in front of family and friends.
In the spirit of community, I wanted to ask both Gary and Sheila if you would join me. It's been such an honor to have Dr. Cheromiah as an advisee. We've known each other for a very long time, but I also know that this was not just my honor, but also the honor of many mentors, many of you who are on Skype, all of you leaders, students, faculty that are out there. There are so many of you. So I hope, just among the three of us, I think we do represent so many who have been there and just cheering you on the journey, many who ran alongside you, many who ran before you and will run after you. And so we just want to congratulate you, Dr. Cheromiah, and if I can ask. So what, why don't we, Gary and I will hold this up. Dr.
Cheromiah, introducing Dr. Cheromiah. Thank you. Thank you so much, everyone. I would also like to honor my committee. Shout out to Uncle Johnny over there at the Coyote store for getting blankets. But I would like to honor you with these blankets and some gifts on behalf of our family. One of the greatest lessons that I've learned from my mom is giving. No matter what you have, you can always give. And ever since I was a little girl, my mom would be the one. We didn't have much sometimes, but she would always find it in her heart to give of herself and of gifts to our community. So in that same spirit, here is some blankets. You can switch them out if you want. I don't even I'm just kind of giving it at random. thank you so much. And my sister and Matt, if you come up here too, I also have one for you. It's also, I know you haven't got a Pendleton gifted to you before, but my sister is a badass editor. I don't know what happened to me. And Matt is the tallest man I know. Thank you so much. And then Madge, my sister Madge Anaya, she's the one that keeps it real for me. All the time she keeps it real. But this one was very specific to pick up for you, Madge, because she's a woman of simplicity. So here's one for you, Madge. So thank you so much. And also, here, like a pizza box. also want to honor police too. Police can come up here and also get this. Here's a blanket for you. Thank you so much for everything. I appreciate you. You've been with me since old school. I love you so much.
I love you.
So funny.
Thank you.
I appreciate you. And for my mom, I got her this special necklace, kind of call it the Deb Holland necklace. But I know she wanted like the silver. So this is to you, Mom. I love you so much and appreciate you. And this is from my buddy, John De Dios. He's my photography mentor. He's a badass photographer. He's taught me a lot. So here's our John, and thank you for coming. Thank you. So I have some more too. Here's Karen. Thank you so much, Karen, for all that you've done. She's a mentor to a lot of us. Here's a Don Autumn basket and a shawl and some earrings. Thank you, Karen. And the other thing is, you know, when we come together, it's not just about the individual we represent, our families and our friends. So Dr. Lee, this is for your mom.
So thank you. She's actually visiting for Mother's Day weekend, so she's gonna pick me up after this.
Awesome. Please get back to your mom. Gary, this is for your wife. I've only met her one time.
give that to her. And Dr. Nicholas, here's for your husband. Here's a mug and some awesome shawl. That's funny. So I think that's it. So again, thank you so much, everyone, for coming. Grandma Obi, I have yours. Hold on. Oh, wait. I have all these sticky notes on here. Hold on. So Grandma Obi, here's a shawl for you. And you're the one that created Grandma's kitchen table effect. So thank you so much for the model, Grandma. Last but not least, Charlinda, my homegirl, who has stood by me. We are very different people. She had her presentation done, her dissertation done, her presentation done about a month before she presented. Full disclosure, I finished my presentation 20 minutes before I started. So she is balances me out, and I love her so much. And thank you so much for coming.
I'm so proud of you. I'm so happy for you. You inspire a lot of people.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Dr. Charlinda Hodley just got her dissertation on passer defense. Okay, that's everybody.
Let me just make a quick announcement. If you don't know, Amanda, Dr. Cheromiah was selected as outstanding graduate student for the College of Education. So hopefully as many of you can join in commencement, well, she'll be giving a short speech on behalf of the graduating class. So please join us for that. She's actually won more awards than I can remember, but do tune in for that. And we just wanna thank you so much, President Robbins, all of you distinguished members here, family members, Dr. Mom and Grandma, Grandma, thank you for coming.
Hey, Mandy! It's Bernita from Supai.
Oh, we love your people, Bernita. Thank you so much. Does anybody have anything to say? I don't know. I can barely see you. You're like little squares. Does anybody want to share anything?
Woo, good job, Mandy. I'm super proud of you. This is my Rhea. Sorry, I can't show my face right now, but yeah. Proud of you. Thank you for inviting everyone to your dissertation defense and for being awesome.
Oh my word, look.
Thank you, Mandy. You are such an inspiration, and you're just continuing to be a mentor to me, and I can't wait until
I get it.
Until you do more work. It's going to be such amazing, all the work that you're doing to the many communities around our tribal nation. Such a blessing. I'm so proud of you.
Thanks, Maria. She's also one of our Native Soil staff members and a dear friend. Thank you, Maria.
Hey, Mandy. Mandy, we say hanjo.
Hey, Mandy. Yasha, this is Carol Davis. I'm so proud of you.
Thank you so much.
Can't believe that you've grown so into a young woman, the woman that you are, and just that first 2 years at class, I already knew you were going to be a scholar.
Thank you. I took 2 years of Navajo, and I just remembered my introduction. Thank you. I appreciate it. Thank you so much.
Hey, Mandy.
Hey, Terry, what's up?
Hi, I'm so proud of you. You're like another daughter to me. You just make me so proud. Such an emotional day for all of us. I can't wait to see you guys later this week.
Thank you.
Yay, Mandy!
Oh, there's a
Mandy.
There's my mentees, Seema and Sedimka. I really
love you guys. You guys inspire me. You're the younger brothers and sisters that I know who are going to come up and lead our people. So I just love both of you so much. You guys changed my life. Thank you.
Mandy.
I'll cry.
Mandy, this is their soul. Esquali, yet beauty, thou nang, I'm auntie, but beauty dancing me among me. In Hopi, I told you, I'm thankful that you have accomplished this goal, not only for yourself, but all of Native America. Esquali.
Thank you.
Dr. Cheromiah, this is Amanda and Coral. We just want to say congratulations to you. I hope that you just soak up all of this good feelings you're feeling. You get a lot of love from different tribes from across this place, and that speaks volumes of who you are as a person. It's so good to see that your mom and your grandma are there celebrating with you. And I just want you to know that we're just so very proud of you. So keep going, Diego, when you're running, because it's going to be tiring sometimes to remember all of these people here gathering today that are supporting you and encouraging you to keep going, Diego. We're just so grateful for all that you have provided many of us. Ayonoshne, love you, Mandy. Dr. Cheromiah.
Love you too, Amanda. It was your dissertation that inspired me for all of this. So thank you. Thank you.
Mandy, Dr. Cheromiah, it's Mike.
Hey, Mike.
Thank you. I'm overwhelmed right now, but thank you so much for everything. Just remember fondly our days as graduate community directors together, studying for our master's comprehensive exams together. And just thank you for this. Thank you for inviting us all to be here today and for modeling what it means to be a scholar and to show love to a community as a human being.
Good afternoon, Mandy. This is Colin.
Hey, Colin.
Congratulations, Dr. Cheromiah. That's awesome. We're so proud of you. I just wanted to echo all the sentiments. You know, you work so hard, and it's so beautiful to hear you present and then to highlight and watch the videos from that the link that you sent us ahead of time. So it just all came together so beautifully. So thank you for teaching us. I can't wait to read your dissertation.
Thank you, Colin. Thank you, Dr. Ben, another Native scholar, man. Thank you.
Hey, Mandy, it's Chris.
Hey, Chris. Dr.
Olin's here.
Hey, Olin.
Congratulations. Very proud of you. We love you.
Thank you. Dr. Nelson was also a huge part of my journey to go to school. She was the one that her and Amanda and Natalie Youngbull, all the doctors, they led the way. And we followed their steps. Me and Charlinda would flip back and forth between all your dissertations to figure out how to do this. Thank you.
Hey, Mandy, it's Karina. So proud of you. It was wild. I felt like I was right there with you, especially when we were roommates for 7-8 years. But to present all together, I'm just so blown away and so proud of you and so impressed. And I can't wait to celebrate.
Thanks, Karina. When I was going through the hard times, Karina and Felice and Randy were a big part of that. They spoke love to me in ways that I didn't see and helped me get to this point. So Karina, you're a huge part of that. Thank you so much.
Love you.
Thank you. Come on, Randy.
I don't want to disrupt the social
business. Anyone else?
I just want to say congratulations, of course, Mandy. And
to the front, so
they
can see you.
Oh, sorry, I'm undressed. I have my Native Sword shirt on.
My department did.
I just want to say that you can say that we're giving you a degree, but you've given us so much credit. It's true.
Wait, hold on, Regina. Hold on.
I was on Zoom seeing you give out gifts, and I was saying, I hope I can give. My goodness, working hard. That's hilarious.
Stickers are the gifts.
10
messages. Anyone else?
Hi, Mandy. I don't know if you remember me, but my name is Melissa Howard. I took your Native Sword class back in the fall of 2017. I really got close with you. You're an amazing, amazing professor, like just following you around, going around and completing my assignments. It was amazing. And I'm just so proud of you. You're a big inspiration for me. And I haven't been in school for a while. And I'm like, you're my motivation to go back. I just want you to know that I'm proud of you and you're an inspiration to everyone. I mean, I've been following you like on Facebook and Instagram, and I just want you to know you're a huge inspiration. I just been following you from the beginning, and I'm so proud of you. Congratulations, Dr. Cheromiah.
Thank you, Melissa. Of course I remember you. Of course. You can do it. I can't wait to go to your graduation for your master's. I believe it. Thank you.
Amanda. Yeah, Amanda, this is Sandy from Chin Lee. I just wanted to say congratulations, Dr. Cheromiah, and thank you so much for reaching out to the youth all the way over here on the res. You know, you supported my students, and even during this pandemic and this remote distance, you offered them, you know, those little mini iPads. So where they're using it, it's relevant. And so thank you so much for always keeping in mind the youth on the res. Congratulations.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
Hi, it's Aura. Sorry. I just wanted to say that I'm so proud of you, and I'm up here on the mountain war hooping for you. It's just really amazing to see you, Dr. Cheromiah. And I just wanted to, you know, echo a lot of your colleagues in saying congratulations, but I also wanted to recognize your master skills as a storyteller within our own communities. And now you've achieved that status within our other community. So congratulations, Dr. Cheromiah.
Laura, I appreciate you. We traveled abroad together for 2 years. Laura is a badass storyteller too. Thank you.
Mandy, congratulations. So proud of you. Muchas felicidades. First time I saw you, you were actually a new start. You were actually giving a speech. That was the first time I ever met you. You actually were pretending, well, I thought you were pretending to be a blind woman. And I remember thinking you were really blind sitting there listening to your speech. I think it was some kind of role play in the dormitory. And it's so funny that, you know, little did I know that that was actually something real, you know, for you. And I remember just sitting there not knowing a single thing about you, feeling so inspired. And today, as I think about the long journey, you know, of school, I see you today now, and I'm just so proud, and I remain as aspire as the first day I saw you. I'm just incredibly proud of you, Mandy. I know that this is the beginning of many things for you, so many blessings to you, and thank you for everything you're going to do on behalf of the Indigenous population and in people in general. You have a big heart, and we all love you, and we're proud of you, Mandy. Congrats.
Thank you, Leslie. I appreciate that. Okay, is there anybody else that has like a burning piece of feedback? Oh man, I'm all sweaty. It's hot in the desert.
our Pueblo people wore like mantas and layers and stuff because it was colder back home. Down here, it's pretty hot. Okay, well, thank you so much, everyone. I really appreciate all of you. I just love you so much. And I hope this was a demonstration of how we indigenize the academy, because we are. We are here. We're not going anywhere. We're here for the long run. So thank you so much, everyone. I appreciate you online and everybody here. I appreciate all of you and love you. Thank you. That's it. Oh yes, Sheila's gonna close with a prayer. Sheila, sorry, water to come. I like to be. It is the my view dancing by Abby and I. Without. Go eat.